can dom, or there is a home that is much better than the one that we already have, the one that we're, usually stuck in. But I can confidently say that everybody's looking for what we have right here in New York. Everybody's looking for the same thing. And it felt so nice to be back home. So nice to be back with our familiar deities, our familiar lords, familiar family, familiar faces. Everything was just so nice. And I was really appreciating Srila Prabhupada's mercy yesterday evening and appreciating his determination to bring Krishna consciousness to a literally God-forsaken place here in some dusty, grimy, grungy quarter of America on some, East Coast that didn't have any of these things, and now we have every day as a festival. So I'm really so incredibly grateful and so happy to be back with everybody. Om Agyanate Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Namah Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatyadeshatarine Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasati Gaura Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. So what a beautiful day of celebration it is for us, of Papa Mochani Ekadashi. We hear of the word mochan from so many different angles. One of them is to kind of cross over. So Sankatamochan, we have crossing over any dangers, hurdles, obstacles. So Papamochani is crossing over, eradicating all of our sins. And this is definitely one of those lectures I feel kind of guided by Paramatma, because I came into it with my own ideas, which was kind of talking about the blessing of devotional family, devotional association, and how incredibly vital it is to our spiritual lives. And then in preparation, I was reading the story of this Ekadashi. And now we will see if Paramatma decides that I can blend my ideas with Paramatma's ideas, or if Paramatma takes over and has Paramatma's own ideas about where this lecture should go. But it felt really interesting in a very cool and nice way to kind of surrender my ideas to Paramatma's greater idea for this lecture. And I do feel like that is definitely a theme. It's, what does that feel like? Are we able to surrender our ideas for how life should go, how our work should go, how our service should go? What does that look like when we then have to surrender all the things that we think are good to what Krishna thinks is best? It's always a very interesting question. I feel like it's something that it's not asked only once in our devotional lives. It's kind of asked every day, every hour, every moment. We are asked and asking ourselves, can we surrender to what Krishna thinks is best? Do those two ideas actually merge? Am I in alignment with what Krishna thinks is best? Am I in agreement with it? And even when things happen that are beyond our control, Can we see that as Krishna's divine guidance for our entire lives? what in the world does that look like when we give ourselves room to kind of surrender in that way? So let's see. The glories of Papamochana Ekadashi. Sri Yudhishthira Maharaj said, O Supreme Lord, I have heard from you the explanation of Amalaki Ekadashi, which occurs during the light fortnight of the month of Phalgun, February, March. And now I wish to hear about the Ekadashi that occurs during the dark fortnight of the month of Chaitra, March, April. What is its name, O Lord? And what results can one obtain by observing it? The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna, replied, O best of kings, for the benefit of everyone, I shall gladly describe to you the glories of this Ekadashi, which is known as Papamochani. The history of this Ekadashi was once narrated to the Emperor Mandata by Lomasa Rishi. King Mandata addressed the Rishi, O great sage, for the benefit of all people, please tell me the name of the Ekadashi that occurs during the dark fortnight of the month of Chaitra, and please explain the process for observing it. Also, please describe the benefits one gains by observing this Ekadashi. Lomasa Rishi replied, The Ekadashi that occurs during the dark part of the month of Chaitra is named Papamochani Ekadashi. For the faithful devotee, it removes the influences of ghosts and demons. That's a very cool trick for this Ekadashi. O lion among men, this Ekadashi also awards the eight perfections of life, fulfills all kinds of desires, purifies one's life of all sinful reactions, and makes a person perfectly virtuous. Now please listen to a historical account concerning this Ekadashi and Chitrarat, the chief of the Gandharvas, heavenly musicians. During the spring season, in the company of heavenly dancing girls, Chitrarat once came upon a beautiful forest, bursting forth with a great variety of flowers. There, he and the girls joined the Gandharvas and many Kinnaras, along with Lord Indra himself, the king of heaven, who was enjoying a visit there. Everyone felt that there was no better garden than this forest. Many sages were also present, performing their austerities and penances. The demigods particularly enjoyed visiting the celestial garden during the months of Chaitra and Vaishakh, April, May. A great sage named Medavi resided in that forest, and the very attractive dancing girls would always attempt to seduce him. Seems like this is like a challenge, you know? It's almost like sport. The moment you try to begin a spiritual life of austerity, it seems as though that is the time when everything tries to seduce you, when material nature herself says, okay, let's give it our best shot. So the dancing girls would always attempt to seduce him. One famous girl in particular, Manju Ghosh, contrived many ways to allure the exalted Muni, but out of great respect for the sage and fear of his power, which he had attained after years and years of asceticism, she would not come very close to him. At a spot 2 miles from the sage, she pitched a tent and began singing very sweetly as she played a tambura. Cupid himself became excited when he saw and heard her perform so nicely and smelled the fragrance of her sandalwood paste unguent. He remembered his own unfortunate experience with Lord Shiva and decided to take revenge by seducing Medavi. So this is a great history that is very popular, but which I will narrate in brief. Once, Lord Shiva was heavily involved in performing tapasya. He had kind of withdrawn himself from the world after losing his dearest companion, Sati. And he decided, I'm not getting involved in anything. No more worldly activities for me, I'm done. And so his tapasya was incredible. His grief was incredible. And so the universe and all of the devatas in the universe were thinking, however, we need Lord Shiva. He is an integral part of the way the cosmos work and function. We need him to come back into the flow of creation, maintenance, annihilation. And so they asked so many different devatas for their help. Finally, Indra employed Cupid. He says, we need you to break the meditation of Lord Shiva. Kamadev was not so keen to this idea. However, following direct orders, he gathers with him his wife, Rati, and so many of his weapons, springtime, flowers, the sweet breezes, so many things. And so he attempts to break Lord Shiva's meditation in order to somehow have Lord Shiva gain the favor or give his favor toward Parvati. In the course of Cupid meddling in these affairs, Lord Shiva is awakened from his tapasya. Lord Shiva opens his third eye and immediately burns Cupid into nothing, my Guru Maharaj says. It's almost like not even ashes, it's nothing. Gone. Rati Devi is completely beside herself with grief. She is wailing, crying, please do something, give me back my consort. Oh, Mahadev, you know what it is like to lose a consort. How can this same affliction come upon me? What will I do now? Lord Shiva gives a caveat, says, well, Cupid will stay, but with a disembodied form. He will be known as Ananga, one who has no limbs. And so now, Cupid often still roams, still doing his job, but now formless. And so it seems as though, according to the glories of this Ekadashi, somehow or other, Cupid remembers his squabble and this incident with Lord Shiva and decides to take revenge on a different unsuspecting sage. Such an interesting way of taking revenge. Shouldn't he usually go and take revenge on the person that he had the incident with? Like, that would make sense to all of us thinking logically. Clearly, we can see that revenge and all of these things do not work according to logic. Not at all, huh? So now Cupid has had a tangle with Lord Shiva. Now he wants to take revenge, and he's now taking revenge with the sage Medavi, who somehow was just doing nothing but minding his own business, living his own life of asceticism. I thought that this was so interesting to look at the devatas as people. Sometimes I look and I see that they have so many more powers, so much more strength than I have, so much more wisdom or access to wisdom than I have. And all of a sudden, I start changing our positions, much like we see often happens with famous people, wealthy people. And just because they may have a few more dollars or access to something more than we have, we start to look at them differently, placing upon them an understanding that they may have decided not to work with at that point. So it was so interesting for me to kind of look at the devatas within Srimad Bhagavatam, the devatas within the workings of material nature as living entities, still dealing with the things that living entities are dealing with: birth, death, old age, disease, lust, anger, greed, envy, revenge. So interesting, because Krishna within Bhagavad Gita is saying that whether you live on this planet or even in the planet of Lord Brahma, there's going to be anxiety. Everyone is struggling with the six senses, which include the mind. So Krishna has been pointing out to Arjuna, it is not so different. No matter where you go, we think we can outrun the material world, but it is not so different. Even if you live on heavenly planets, even if you have access to supernatural powers, mystical siddhis, so many things, you can't outrun this material nature. So let's see what we do with it instead. So Cupid approached Manjugosh, Using the eyebrows of Manju Ghosh as a bow, her glance as a bowstring, her eyes as arrows, and her breasts as a target, Cupid used Medavi in order to tempt. Cupid approached Medavi in order to tempt him to break his trance and his vows. In other words, Cupid engaged Manju Ghosh as his assistant, and when she looked at that powerful and attractive young sage, she also became agitated by lust. Seeing that he was highly intelligent and learned, wearing a clean white Brahmin's thread draped across his shoulder, holding a sannyasi's staff, and sitting handsomely in the ashram of Chavana Rishi, Manju Ghosh came before him. She began to sing seductively, and the small bells of her belt and around her ankles, together with the bangles on her wrists, produced a delightful musical symphony. The sage Medavi was enchanted. He understood that this beautiful young woman desired union with him, and at that instant, Cupid increased his attraction for Manju Ghosh by releasing his powerful weapons of taste, touch, sight, smell, and sound. Slowly, Manju Ghosh approached Medavi, her bodily movements and sweet glances attracting him. She gracefully put her tambura down and embraced the sage with her two arms, just as a creeper winds itself around a strong tree. Captivated, Medavi gave up his meditation and decided to sport with her, and instantly his purity of heart and mind abandoned him. Forgetting even the difference between night and day, he went away with her to sport for a long, long time. Seeing that the young yogi's sanctity had become seriously eroded, Manju Ghosh decided to abandon him and return home. She said, "O Great One, please permit me to return home." Medavi replied, "But you have only just arrived, O beautiful one. Please stay with me at least until tomorrow." Fearful of the sage's yogic power, Manju Ghosh stayed with Medavi for precisely 57 years, 9 months, and 3 days. But to Medavi, all this time seemed like a moment. Again, she asked him, "Please permit me to leave." Medavi replied, "O dear one, listen to me. Stay with me for one more night, and then you may leave tomorrow morning. Just stay with me until I've performed my morning duties and chanted the sacred Gayatri Mantra. Please wait until then." Manju Ghosh was still fearful of the sage's great yogic power, but she forced a smile and said, "How long will it take you to finish your morning hymns and rituals? Please be merciful and think of all the time you have already spent with me." The sage reflected on the years he had been with Manju Ghosh and then said with great astonishment, "Why, I've spent more than 57 years with you." His eyes turned red and began to emanate sparks. He now regarded Manju Ghosh as death personified and the destroyer of his spiritual life. "You rascal woman, you have turned all the hard-earned results of my austerities to ashes." Trembling with anger, he cursed Manju Ghosh. "O sinful one, O hard-hearted, degraded one, you know only sin. May all terrible fortune be yours. O rascal woman, I curse you to become an evil hobgoblin. Pishacha." Cursed by the sage Medavi, the beautiful Manju Ghosh humbly beseeched him, "O best of the Brahmanas, please be merciful to me and revoke your curse." "O Great One, it is said that association with pure devotees gives immediate results, but their curses take effect only after 7 days, as we see in the case of Maharaj Purukkit. I have been with you for 57 years. O Master, please be kind to me." Medavi Muni replied, "O gentle lady, what can I possibly do? You have destroyed all my austerities, but even though you have done this sinful deed, I shall tell you a way you can be released from my wrath. In the dark fortnight of the month of Chaitra, there is an all auspicious Ekadashi that removes all one's sins. Its name is Papa Mochini. O beautiful one, whoever fasts on this sacred day becomes completely freed from having to take birth in any kind of devilish form." With these words, the sage left at once for his father's ashram. Seeing him enter the hermitage, Javana Muni said, "O son, by acting unlawfully, you have squandered the wealth of your penances and austerities." Medavi replied, Oh, Father, kindly reveal what atonement I must perform to remove the obnoxious sin I have incurred by privately associating with the dancing girl Manju Ghosh. Shravana Muni answered, Dear son, you must fast on Papamochani Ekadashi, which occurs during the dark fortnight of the month of Chaitra. It eradicates all sins. It's like, you know, put that on everything. Papamochani Ekadashi for all. It eradicates all sins, no matter how grievous they may be. Medavi followed his father's advice and fasted on Papamochani Ekadashi. Thus all his sins were destroyed, and he again became filled with excellent merit. Similarly, Manju Ghosh observed the same fast and became free of the hobgoblin curse. Ascending once again to the heavenly spheres, she too returned to her former position. Lomasa Rishi continued, Thus, O King, the great benefit of fasting on Papamochani Ekadashi is that whoever does so with faith and devotion will have all his sins completely destroyed. Sri Krishna concluded, O King Yudhisthira, whoever reads or hears about Papamochani Ekadashi obtains the very same merit he would get if he donated 1,000 cows in charity. And he also nullifies the sinful reactions he may have incurred by killing a brahmana, killing an embryo in the womb, drinking liquor, or having sex with his guru's wife. Such is the incalculable benefit of properly observing this holy day of Papamochani Ekadashi, which is so dear to me and so meritorious. Thus ends the narration of the glories of Chaitra Krishna Ekadashi, or Papamochani Ekadashi, from the Bhavishya Uttara Purana. So you can kind of see now why it's kind of wondering about my focus on devotional families and the importance of them after this Ekadashi, where everybody seemed kind of a little bit angst-ridden and very angry. However, what I kind of also felt was, just like my Guru Maharaj points out that in the story of Jadabharat, we can look at Jadabharat and be angry at the deer. And many people have been angry at the deer. Jadabharat was a king. He was Maharaj Bharat. He goes to the forest, does everything he is supposed to do. He then adopts a baby deer and becomes so taken with the deer that in his last moments of life, all he can think of is the deer. And he takes his next life as a deer. Sometimes devotees have looked at this example from Srimad Bhagavatam and thought, you know, never have pets. Just never show affection for animals, because then next thing you know, you're thinking about your cat, dog, bunny, rabbit, hamster at the end of your life, and that is what you will become. And after years of hearing that kind of takeaway from that pastime, I was listening in one lecture, my Guru Maharaj says, the problem was not the deer. The problem was Jadabharat's lack of devotee association. There was no other association to tell him, bro, you're going off the wrong path. Come back. Come back. The deer is fine. The deer will be fine. At this point, at the end of your life, just think of Krishna. Don't worry about the deer. Don't worry about it. The deer will be okay. So the problem wasn't the deer. It was the lack of devotee association. Similarly, I feel as though the sage Medavi, the problem was not Manju Ghosh. The problem was the lack of devotee association to say, Medavi, do you know it's been 57 years? There was no one there to tell him differently, except for Manju Ghosh, who was also fearful. And she was also kind of just acting in a way that had been produced within her by different greater powers. I say all this to say, like, if we don't think that planets are exerting their effect on us, and that other devatas are exerting their effects on us, I mean, we do rule our lives by the travelings of the moon. Just, you know, we wouldn't have a Kadashi if we weren't living according to the workings of different planets. So, the problem was not Manju Ghosh. The problem was the lack of other devotee association to bring us back, to remind us of where home is, where our foundation is, where our anchor is. So I was just kind of looking, and there were so many ways that revenge, anger played a part in this incredible pastime. And I feel as though it's easier to be angry than to feel the deeper feelings, the disappointment, the grief, the overwhelm, the anxiety, the how can I make this back? I feel as though the sage Medhavi, when he realizes I've spent 57 years and I forgot everything that I was doing before, there is a sense of all my hard work, I lost it. And it's easier to be angry with someone than to really face, oh no, what have I done? Which he still does wind up facing at the end. It's a little bit of what have I done? How can I ever recover from this? And we know we've all been in situations similarly where we're thinking, what have I done? How do I get back from this? And sometimes we find it easier to be angry with somebody else. But what I realized from traveling to Rishikesh and Vrindavan is you can't outrun it. Our stuff is going to follow us. We ever think, okay, I'll go on a spiritual retreat, I'll go to someplace else, I'll do these different things, and then you get there, and somehow or other, the common denominator is you. Like, you ever figure that out? Like, all of the things that are wrong with my life, and then you're like, I'm gonna go on a retreat, I'm gonna change my location, I'm gonna change my surroundings, I'm gonna change my associate, and then sometimes we find out that the problem is us. We are the common denominator. Then what happens? Rather than dealing with the grief and the overwhelm of all of that, we tend to get angry. Krishna has already outlined human psychology in Bhagavad Gita. From contemplating the objects of the senses, one develops attachment for them. From that attachment, lust develops. When lust goes unsatisfied and unfulfilled, there is anger. From anger, we have bewilderment of memory. We have general delusion. All intelligence is lost. One falls down back into the pool of material existence, doing things that we would never think to say or do. But it all comes from contemplating the objects of the senses. So when I found it very appropriate, you know, they said Cupid then employed all of his weapons, taste, touch, smell, sight, sound. They start contemplating those objects of the senses. And that lust, as we can see in the case of poor sage Medhavi, is never fulfilled. No matter how much time he spent with Manju Ghosh, it was never enough. Please just stay one more day, stay one more night, stay just a few more hours. I can't give this up. It is never fulfilled. And then, when that lust is frustrated, because it can only be frustrated, we are angry. We start lashing out at the different, you know, causes of our lust. And so Arjuna is telling Krishna, well, then, Krishna, what do I do? Saying, you have to conquer the sitting places of that lust, which is even within the mind, within the senses. The soul can somehow or other conquer the many sitting places of lust that reside within the body and even within the mind and the intelligence. It clouds over all of our intelligence. And so, you know, sometimes this lust can be very overt. Sometimes the lust can be incredibly subtle. Sometimes the lust is our ego telling us, do you know who you are? You are the sage Medhavi. You had so much tapasya, so much merit accrued. You had all of these things. Now look, you've lost it. Now what are you? Now who are you? Now that you've made this mistake, what will become of your life? Who are you? That lust combined with our ego to tell us, oh no, we've lost the keys to our very own being. He had to go seek out association. He goes to Chavana Muni, his own father, and says, what do I do now? Who am I? Now that I've lost the key to my identity. But the keys to our identity can be our devotional service. When we are linked into our devotional service, it's widely known that that lust turns to love. And when that lust cannot be unfulfilled, but it turns to love, then we have, at the highest pinnacle, we have the heart of Srimati Radharani, which is described as a heart filled with love and compassion, like an ocean that has no bottom and no shore. But now it is filled with grace, mercy, all of the most wonderful things in creation. It is this compassionate heart which gives rise to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's own heart, his own desire to give this holy name to everyone, give this loving mentality to everyone. And indeed, he tells Rupa and Sanatan Goswami three things. Chant the holy names, perform non-seva. Worship the devotees, Vaishnav seva. And Jiva Doya, have compassion for all the living entities. Because when we are in touch with that devotional service, somehow or other, our identity is now linked to, how can I make Krishna happy? Where is the pleasure of my Lord? Somehow or other, that pleasure of my Lord is then linking me to all of the things that I work best with in life. Devahuti runs to her son Kapila Dev in the third canto and says, I am sick of material creation. I'm sick of material life. I'm sick of it. I'm done. Tell me what to do. And he says that devotees are not afflicted by material miseries, because they are always somehow in constant remembrance of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is our protection. This is our shield. So what do we do then when we've made these mistakes? Well, our identities are no longer tethered to those mistakes. We go and we run and we seek out devotee association. We find our devotional family, the devotee association that would have brought Jatabharat back, the devotee association that Medavi, Rishi, ran to seek out to solve his issues. The devotee association and the devotee family that Devahuti now is seeking when she is sick of material life. This is our shield. This is what helps us say, let us remember the glories and qualities and pastimes of our dear most supreme personality of Godhead, and that will be our protection. I was really jet lagged yesterday, so I'd been meditating on that verse from Srimad Bhagavatam where Kapila Dev gives this, you know, we'll always be protected from material miseries. And so yesterday I was incredibly jet lagged. And I thought, you know what? I've been meditating on this verse. Let me try it. You know, Krishna consciousness is a science. Scientific method, they told me you have a hypothesis. You've got to do some trial and error. We must try it out. So I said, let me try it out. And all of a sudden, I started yawning. So much. It was like one after the other. And I thought, well, if I'm supposed to link everything to my remembrance of Krishna's qualities, forms, and pastimes, see, Adi Prabhu, you're also yawning. I thought, what can I link this to? And I remembered, there's a great incident of a battle between Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva, where Lord Krishna, in order to incapacitate Lord Shiva, hits him with a yawning weapon, where Lord Shiva decides he's just yawning uncontrollably. He can't do anything else in battle. He sits down and he takes a nap. And I thought, Lord, I've also been hit by a yawning weapon. And it just made me smile. I wasn't thinking about the jet lag anymore. I wasn't thinking about anything else except for the fact that this is part of Krishna's pastimes and how yawning can really incapacitate a person. You get teary-eyed, you really feel like everything else stops, everything outside stops, and all I could think about. But amazingly, just thinking about that one pastime, it was true. The miseries of material life cannot touch us. They will still be there. It doesn't mean that there are not things that happen. They will happen. But somehow or other, we are protected through the remembrance of Krishna's form, name, qualities, and pastimes. There is a sweetness to it all. Somehow or other, Krishna enters into our existence at every moment. in every possible situation. Whether sleep deprived or not, jet lagged or not, yawning or not, Krishna is there with us in every single situation. All it takes is our willingness to run towards the devotee association, to run towards Srimad Bhagavatam, which can become a best friend. Run towards that devotee association instead of wanting to be angry and seek revenge when these things come upon us. Bhima Prabhu, please tell me something. Was at that moment that made
Haribo,
it.
Haribo, Prabhu Jini. I was actually going to lower my hand because I raised it when you were talking about the sage. Pa, hold on for a second. Close the gate. Horses, somebody said the other day, as we all know, horses represent the senses. And it's okay. It's just a phone. And they can be wild at times, and they very much emulate the courtships of all animals emulate each other in their courtships and their being out of control when passion overtakes them. Horses, cows are in the mode of goodness, and horses have goodness and a whole lot of passion. So one gets to see a lesson every day. We have males and mares and geldings. Geldings are like brahmacharis. By proxy. And then we had a stallion once, and that was nothing but trouble. So we can see that. And when I said trouble, I mean, you know, fights and fences going down, and we basically had to geld. So we understand that this, and I say this before you, I put my hand up on this point, that we tend to think that we have control over this, that somehow, especially when we first joined the movement, that we can somehow subdue lust. And that lust doesn't have to be just gross. It can also be a lust ambition, ambition for power, ambition to rise in the ranks, ambition to get distinction, to get adoration. You know, this is lust in all its forms. And it's so important, as you would have said, that in the association of devotees, especially those devotees whom you can confide in, they keep you on the straight and narrow. They'll tell you straight up, you know, Prabhu, you're getting out of hand. You know, you're in the grand illusion, Prabhu, right? As soon as you do something or say something off or start acting in such a way, I know that when I go down to New York and I start ranting and raving about something, Das, Adi Purush, Ananda Bihari, et cetera, they'll all, like, you know, cock their heads and say, Prabhu, you're an illusion. Or you go back to the farm and Domi, I don't know if you know Domi. Domi used to say Bhima's up in the woods, jumping up and down in the woods screaming, you know. So these things, if you don't have the devotees to tell you where you're at, then the tendency to fall into the grand illusion is very, very strong. And not just as a karmi, but even as a devotee, the tendency to fall into an illusion based on pride or misunderstanding of the scriptures is very, very strong. And as Prabhupada said, and I'll end it here, Prabhupada used to pray, you know, for Krishna to keep him from Maya. And we all think that that's hyperbole, that, you know, Prabhupada, he'd never fall into Maya, but he truly meant it. He knew this, that's something that a lot of us in the West do not know, and that is we're in a magic show, and we can be pulled out of our we can be pulled out of our sobriety like a rabbit being pulled from a hat. And that we always have to depend on Krishna. And Krishna says, if you depend on my devotees, I'm there. So thank you very much for elaborating on that point, how important it is for Sadhu Sangha and for us to always have somebody to confide in confidence, and to confess our thoughts to, so that we always remain sincere, which is the most important thing, that we can have in Krishna consciousness, of all the austerities that we can have, sincerity is the most important. Hare Krishna.
Jai. I agree. And I do feel as though it's a two-way responsibility, you know? We have to have those people that we can confess our minds and our hearts to, who will guide us back to the right path and let us know when we're going off track. And then similarly, when someone comes to us in crisis, we have to embody the instruction of Jivadoya, of being compassionate when the person comes to us and says those things. Because, you know, we could be all eager to like browbeat somebody down. Yes, you are absolutely a nonsense. I've known it for 6 months. I was just waiting for you to come and tell me. Glad you can finally see the light. But the most important thing that Rupa and Sanatana Goswami would remind each other about was Lord Chaitanya's instruction for Jivadoya, compassionately talking to one another. Rupa Goswami, you know, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu writes that revealing one's mind and confidence and also hearing. So being that trustworthy source that is not going to completely knock down somebody who is already coming and confiding. Just like the sage Madhavi could have gone to his father and his father could have been like, you know better. What were you thinking? Instead, he simply gives him the solution. Don't worry. There's always a way back. You know, don't worry. There was such hope and such kindness. There didn't seem to be such a big battle over what have you done for the past 57 years and you've wasted 57 years of your life. Simply, there was a compassionate solution. And I thought that was such a beautiful example from Shastra, that we can give compassionate solutions rather than digging into what the person already probably feels really badly about. Fun fact, Krishna gave Sudama Brahman his wealth because he understood that subtly, deep down within the heart of Sudama, there was some pride in his own renunciation. Krishna could understand that Sudama had some very small amount of pride in his former renunciation. And so in order to break that pride, so that Sudama...
No, just put it up there. Is it to the deep?
I think it is. Moments is
Anjati Maya. vigrahya Govinda
Jai Shri Shri Radha Muralidhara Shri Gaur Chandra Srila Prabhupada Shri Acyuta Gopi Ki Jai. Thank you, wonderful class. When you were narrating the story, and especially about how he treated the girl after enjoying with her for 52 years, I was like, what a guy, what a twisted guy. I was about to break my phone against the ground. I was so angry. But then you glorified Ekadasi. It all can be redeemed by following the Kadashi and by sticking to the association of the devotees. That is such a wonderful class, wonderful point. Thank you, Acyuta Gopi. And we see Bhima Prabhu, he's not afraid to become a horse in his next life because he's an association of the devotees.
That would be a step up for me.
Also,
it would. I would finally taste what it would be like to be in the mode of goodness. I just wanted to quickly say something, if I may. Can I?
Please.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, in the beginning of the movement, there was this sort of negative view of marriage, because philosophically speaking, it meant a lifetime of attachments. But I'll tell you something. If you marry a Krishna conscious spouse, male, female, and you both pay attention to what it's all about, that Krishna is the cynosure, that Prabhupada is your guide. There's no quicker way to, first of all, because you have a spouse who knows you through and through, they will keep you on the straight and narrow. You'll never become deluded. A wife, at least as a husband, a good wife, will never allow her husband to fall into a illusion. And she depends on the husband to always be the example, to be the leader. And then, of course, she leads by subterfuge, by being someone who always, advises the husband, this is the way that we should run our household. This is the way that we should treat our children. This is the way that we should, view our circumstances. So that devotee association, especially when two are married in Krishna consciousness, can be the most wonderful, eye-opening path back to true knowledge of what this is all about. It's very easy if you're going it alone for Maya to get a hold of you, and mentally speaking, and to lead you down the wrong path. And the worst thing, of course, of all is pride. And if you're in a good Krishna conscious marriage, the last thing that you're going to develop is pride, because your spouse is going to be right on top of you for that. So I just wanted to just mention the glories of Krishna conscious marriage. Hare Krishna.
My sister always says that Krishna conscious family life gives you an opportunity to perform Vaishnav Seva, the likes of which you never would have performed before. You find yourself performing all kinds of services that you never thought you would be doing, like you have children, and how often are you then literally wiping the backsides of other Vaishnavas? We hear of this happening between people in antiquity, and they had to like wait and hide in bushes, and do all kinds of things. They had to go and and make sneak attacks to try and like clean up the bathroom situations of other Vaishnavas. It's okay. Live in a household for 1 week. It'll be your turn to clean the bathroom. Vaishnav Seva. But yeah, it is so incredible. And we often have to remind ourselves, because when the going gets tough, and it will get tough, we get to remind ourselves that this is not a step back in our Krishna consciousness. It is like an arrow on a bowstring, tightening the tension and then propelling us forward light years ahead, if we can maintain the right mentality. But I really, really want to hear from Damodar Priya.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much, Acyuta Gopi Prabhu. And I actually wanted to, before my share, I wanted to highlight the question in the chat from Kartik Prabhu. They said, thank you for another wonderful class. Was Medavi angry because his lust for Devahuti was denied, or because his initial lust for liberation without devotional service denied, or both?
So in regards to that, Medavi was with Manju Ghosh. Devahuti was the wife of Kapila Dev and mother of Kapila Dev and wife of Kardama Rishi. But so Medavi, I think this, to me, my reading of it was a very classic case of what Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita: when lust goes unfulfilled, anger develops. And unfortunately, what Krishna tells, spoiler alert, lust can never be fulfilled. It's always raging hotter and hotter, burning more and more. So it's not that it was denied. She stayed with him for 57 years, 9 months, 3 days, for like precisely, you know? She had it down to the day. So she was like, I've been with you for 57 days. And she was quite afraid to even mention that, because she knew that him understanding how much time he had lost in his tapasya, which seemed to be one of the most close things to him, and he had developed some, it's hard not to develop a little bit of pride in what you do, you know, the pride in what you've been doing for years and years before. He had been doing just this tapasya, and then for 57 years he had not done it at all. Losing that type of spiritual merit, which we are underestimating what great power that comes with. Comes with psychic powers, it comes with all kinds of mystical powers, it comes with all kinds of things. And so the loss of all of that and all of that time, she knew was going to make him upset. She knew it, and that's why she always said she was very afraid of his yogic power and she didn't want to bring it up too much. She's like, but please allow me to leave. And whereas we see in the case of Bilva Mangala Thakur, he was willingly running to a prostitute who finally said, if only you used all of this obsession to be obsessed with God, then you would have really done something with all of this energy and time that you've spent on me. It's like, if only. She's like, because I can't give you what you want. She's like, I'm not meant to be in this kind of tied down relationship. I cannot give you what you want. But if only you had given that kind of obsession to God. Which doesn't mean that we can't also, you know, Bhakti Chitta Maharaj used to say, your marriage is a pyramid. You know, there's you, the spouse, and then there's God. There's Krishna right in there. Your marriage is not just the two of you. It's not a line, it's a pyramid. And so, you know, with her saying, if only you could have directed that obsession towards spiritual pursuits. Think of all you could have gained, and that is never lost. Krishna says, in this endeavor, there's no loss, no diminution, and a little advancement on the path is enough to save one from the most dangerous type of fear. So we have to take it at Krishna's word, on his promise, that when we get into devotional pursuits, even if we fall away from the path, because Arjuna asks, well then, what is the fate of one who takes to this devotional service and then doesn't complete it? She says, you don't have to worry. There is no loss for you. All is not lost. You will be right here ready to pick up. Don't worry. Krishna says, I take control then. You are under my divine nature at that moment. So with the sage Medavi, I think that I can't say that he had a lust for liberation without devotional service, but it is easy for us to become lusty and attached to so many things, including our devotional service. But Krishna somehow finds a way. And that's why I was, you know, kind of wondering, am I attached to my version of how the lecture should go, or am I just able to do my devotional service? Am I able to go with what Krishna thinks should happen in this lecture? Am I able to surrender to Krishna's will of how things should go in this lecture? And somehow our two ideas merged. Somehow or other, I was able to bring it in alignment with what Krishna desired, which was to speak about the glories of devotee association in all of its forms. Sadhu Sangha in all of its forms, whether that is in a relationship, whether that is simply in a relationship of friendship. It is said that Krishna had innumerable, an uncountable amount of cowherd boys, which meant that they all had to have parents. And all of those parents somehow had to say, we are going to have children with the hope that my children will become Krishna's best friend. There was one couple, they had a child. He looked like Krishna. It's a little Krishna. They said, his name will be Krishna. And they said, yes, but we already have one. That's going to be confusing. They said, well, fine. We'll call him Stoka Krishna, little Krishna. And he will be Krishna's best friend. All everybody wanted, just have my child become Krishna's best friend. An uncountable amount of cowherd boys. That's not even counting the gopis. So all of Vrindavan is working with everyone thinking with this obsessive nature, somehow or other, let me contribute to Krishna's pastimes. So whether this is in a mood of being a parent, whether this is in the mood of being a friend, whether this is in the mood of being a lover, whether this is in the mood of just giving Krishna his own protection as a servitor, whatever the case is, somehow, if we can dovetail our lust into an obsession for devotional service, then as Kapila Muni says, then we can be protected by the memory of Krishna's name, form, qualities, and pastimes. We'll be protected from material miseries because somehow or other our minds and our hearts are always within those pastimes, which means we are always within those pastimes. I hope that that answered the question.
Thank you. And then what I wanted to share was when you were giving class, it reminded me of a prayer that Rukmini Walker Prabhu recently shared part of her Patreon. And when she's not traveling, she does Krishna book every Wednesday, which is amazing. And she shared that every single day she prays to Krishna, dear Krishna, please help me and my loved ones have the association of sincere devotees at the time of death to remind us of you. And she prays that every single day. And I just thought that was so powerful, not only as that a reminder that she does that for herself, but that she gives that sincere prayer out, not just for herself, but for all her loved ones. And I thought it was just such a great example of how we can, as you said, like dovetail, you know, and pray for others. And then I was also wanted to share about devotee association. It came up in the chat about how it has been real a big lifeline, especially during the pandemic, to have that virtual association with devotees. And that really was like literally a lifeline for me. Like it really helped me kind of keep my mental health kind of from going down. And it came up like, well, but it doesn't replace in person. Like it's not as good as in person. And my thought on that was, you know, but it's much better than none. You know, and I feel like sometimes as devotees, we get into this like black and white mentality of like zero or none. Like if we can't do it perfectly, then we can't do it at all. And if we can't have in-person association, then, you know, like then the rest of it is not worth it. And I think it's really dangerous because then we keep ourselves from having these opportunities of really creative ways to connect with other devotees. Like, for example, like, you know, this Srimad Bhagavatam class, like having this daily association on Zoom. I have friends that I made during the pandemic that I've never met in person that now are even stronger friends than some of my in-person friends because of the consistency, right? It's not about the in-person, but it's about the consistency. Like we meet every week for an hour online. We see each other's faces. We talk about Krishna Katha. We talk about each other's Krishna consciousness. And that consistency has made that intimacy. And we're able to kind of hold on, you know, keep each other up in terms of our Krishna consciousness. So, and we've never met in person. So again, I'm not saying to replace it. Obviously, I love being able to have in-person association, but that intimacy can be there regardless of whether it's in person or not. So that's just my little two cents. Thank you so much, Haribo.
I feel like devotee association works very much the same as the glories of Ekadashi. They started for one who faithfully even hears this story of Ekadashi. You get so much merit. It eradicates all sins. And some people go, how can just hearing a story eradicate all sins? If you don't think it can, it won't. But if you have faith that it will do even more than you think. And so Sadhu Sangha, if you have no faith in it, then it won't work virtually. If you have absolute faith that even one moment's association, virtual or even within a book, because Srila Prabhupada says, associate with me through my books, that's virtual. We don't have Srila Prabhupada sitting beside us, but we do have Srimad Bhagavatam, who is our best friend. We have Srila Prabhupada because he said, if you have faith, then it will. It will give you everything. It is the same with the holy name. If we have faith, the holy name will give us everything. And if we don't have faith, then the holy name will give us what we desire, which is the lack mentality. But the holy name always gives. It is dependent upon us what the holy name will give, what the Sadhu Sangha will give. So I feel like it is so imperative for us to enter in to these spiritual realms of devotee association, reading Srimad Bhagavatam, prayer, kirtan, japa, with faith. We have to have that faith, which is our conviction. I know it as surely as I know that I'm residing in this body. I absolutely know that Ekadashi Devi will eradicate all sins, even the sins that we think are new sins. Which those sins, you know, sometimes we think is eternal damnation. Sometimes the sin is just a more sinful condition of life. And we know what that's like. We don't have to wait for hell, right? Like, you know, heaven or hell, we don't have to wait for it. It can all be here at a moment's notice. Because if we have faith, all of the holy places reside wherever Krishna's name is spoken. If we have faith, then we are in Vrindavan right here, right now. If we have faith, then this devotee association saves our lives. It all depends on if we have courage enough to have faith. Can we open our hearts and be vulnerable to have that faith? It's like a lifelong question, but it's a really cool adventure, which is worth going on.
Jai, thank you. Thank you, Prabhus and Prabhujinis, for being our association. Srila Prabhupada used a dictaphone to write his books. There's nothing wrong with Zoom or any other technology, as long as the vibration is entering the ear. Okay. Thank you, Acyuta Gopi. Wonderful class. Welcome back. Are you going to take a nap after this? What's the plan?
I thought about that, but I should probably exercise some faith and chant some japa.
Yeah, japa. Wonderful. Yeah, Srila Prabhupada gave us things to do. Japa to chant, books to read, devotees to hang out with. No problem. There's nothing is holding us back. Thank you, Trina Gopi. Wonderful class. Again, thanks everyone for being here, for smiling, for keeping your cameras on. Nothing is holding us back. Yeah, that's my takeaway. All right. Hare Krishna, Hare Ram. Love you all. Hare Bol.